Good morning. Good morning. It is great to see you today. Thank you so much for joining us in worship. Let's start this morning with a word of prayer. Let's pray together. Loving God, we thank you for this beautiful day, for the opportunity to gather, to be with one another in what we like to call the great outdoors out here. And we thank you for your presence. Move in us and through us, through the people that have helped to prepare this service, our musicians, all of the folks who have come together to worship you. We ask that you be with us now and in this time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Great to have you here today. We were talking earlier, and I think we've got, as the weather warms up a little bit, we've got a shift into the shade over here. We got movement toward the shade, and we've got some shade over here as well. You know, in my many, many years of marriage to Julia, I've discovered some things, and one of those things is that my wife Julia loves caves. She loves like crawling through caves, things like that. And caves, C-A-V-E, yeah. And so early in our marriage, we were near some sort of a cavern or something, and she says, "Oh, it's the caverns. We've got to go in there." And I said, "Really?" And she said, "Yeah, they have a guided tour." And then we kind of looked into it, and it was like a two-hour tour through these caverns, and it's pitch dark, and I'm not really so sure about that. No, it's going to be great. And end up, you know, kind of crawling through these little narrow tunnels, and it's kind of wet and damp, and there's no light at all except for the what the guides have. Well, over the years, there's been more and more occasions to go through caves, and I've kind of, it's not the easiest thing for me, but then one day we were at, I think it might have been like Wind Cave National Monument or National Park, whatever it is, and she just really wanted to go in this one cave, and it was like a three hour thing in the cave. We went through it, and we got done, and I was kind of like, "Whew, I'm glad that's over." And then she goes, "You know what? They have a special lantern tour where you can just go in with just lanterns at night, at 8 o'clock at night. And then, you know, and then you turn out your lanterns at some point." And I was like, "No, I can't do it. I just didn't think I could go through with it." Anyway, I did. But the point of the little story is that our convictions can change due to love. Love can allow our convictions to change. That's the point of that little story. Now, that's kind of a humorous story, but it's also a larger theme in the book that we're looking at right now, Les Miserables. And so today we're going to talk about the concept of love, what love is all about from a Christian perspective, how it plays in to the story of Les Miserables, and how our convictions can change due to the power of love. That's our theme as we worship together today. Again, it's great to see you. So glad to have you here today. I'm going to invite you to stand so we can be together as our musicians lead us today. Let's stand and share with one another. Our musicians will lead us right now.
Talk together for a while and ask where we begin to build a world where love can grow and hope can enter in, to be the hands of healing and to plant the seeds of peace, singing welcome, welcome to this place, you're invited to come and know God's grace. All are welcome, the love of love to share. All of us are welcome here. All are welcome in this place. Let's walk together of a time when share a feast, where pride and power kneel to serve the lonely and the least. And joy will set the table as we join our hands to pray, singing, welcome, welcome to this place. You're invited to come and know God's grace. All are welcome, the love of God to share, 'cause all of us are welcome here. All are welcome in this
seated. Thank you, music team. Gets us off to a great start today. And once again, greetings to all of you and hello to everyone viewing us on the live stream and also the video version today. We are pleased to have you with us. And I want to just highlight some of our standard things this morning. We've got restrooms off to the left. Through the social hall in the hallway there right in front of the reception office. Second, there are name tags on the table in the back, and we invite you to put one of those on. I think it helps everybody. We've got helpers in the back that can help you with that, and it helps allow us to figure out who's who. Also, we will give you instructions a little bit later on those communion cups, and hopefully you got one as you came in today. If you didn't get one, raise your hand up, or if you require gluten-free, let us know. One of our helpers will get over to you. We have an offering box in the back. It's on the table in the back. Beth Brower has a kind of a hat on there. She's raising her hand right now. And your offerings can be placed in that box following our service today. If you are joining us on live stream or the filmed version of the video, filmed worship video, I should say, you can go to a link on our website. It's on the worship page. The link will take you to a secure site, and you can make an electronic donation there. Many folks have also been sending checks directly to our church. We are so appreciative of that. We're so appreciative of all of you. Your gifts and offerings have allowed our ministries to continue, and we are so grateful for that. This past week, we took those first steps toward reopening our classrooms and social hall on a limited capacity. We had a few of our small groups back in the building this past week. Yay! Great news. And we're now making plans to bring our worship back into the sanctuary on June 6th. June 6th. Later this week, we will send out an information sheet outlining what that will look like. Please look for that in your email this coming week. I also want to reemphasize that if you have a committee or a small group, a circle, or other smaller gatherings that have traditionally met in the building, you can meet inside now by schedule with Rhiannon ahead of time. Limits are still in place, masks, distancing, caps on the number of persons allowed in each room. And remember, you might get a different room than wherever it was that you were meeting before. I want to make just a quick comment about these beautiful flowers that are sitting right here on our communion table. Those flowers have been given by Richard Oba in memory of Sydney, Bill, and Jeanette Pusick. And so we thank Richard for those beautiful flowers. And I think Richard may be viewing us either live stream or on the filmed version. And thank you, Richard, for those. Well, now let's continue our worship today with our children's special time. Kids, come on down. I see some chairs right up here. So we're going to have you grab chairs, and I'm going to go right down here. Emma and Eric, good to see you guys today. How are you? Good. Hey, I brought one of my favorite things today. Remember this? Have you seen one of these before?
Yeah.
Do you guys have one?
Yeah.
Do you like it? Do you do lots of tricks with it and stuff?
Yeah.
About 3 days ago, I was looking on my dresser in my bedroom, and I saw my yo-yo sitting there. I said, wow, there's my yo-yo. I haven't really done my yo-yo recently. So I took it out, did a little couple of ups and downs. I'm not really very good, as you can tell. Oh, that wasn't supposed to happen. Oh, how embarrassing. I thought I had it down. Well, you know, people that are really good at yo-yos, they can do all sorts of tricks. Like, can you guys do some tricks? Maybe you're really good. What can you do, Emma? Want to show me? Want to do it? Do something? Maybe you're better. No? Okay, how about this? Because we got all these people watching. How about after the service you can show me? After. That'll be good, right? Okay. So, yeah, let's see. Whoops. Not really working. Okay, I'm taking too much time. Okay, so why did I bring a yo-yo today? Well, I was thinking about sometimes we, when something bad happens to us, we kind of don't pay attention to God anymore because maybe we're mad at God or we're sad, like, Like when I went away from when I went away to college, it always seems to happen when people go away to college, right? I didn't always go to church every week. And so in some ways it was like I was running, I was going away from God, right? Okay, come on. Bring it back up. Here. I think it's this microphone's getting in the way. On all my trials, it worked fine. So then you're kind of go away and you kind of stay away from God. Or maybe like when I was a kid, I had a little hamster and he died. And so I was kind of mad at God because my hamster died. So I didn't really pray to God during that time. But every time that I've gone away from God, God has brought me back. You know, so it's like I'm away from God and then God brought me back. Away from God, God brought me back. Okay, so I always think of the yo-yo. Like sometimes we move away from God, sometimes we go back. Sometimes we move away, sometimes we go back. And I was thinking about it because we have a song at the very end of our service today. Our 9:30 music team, they're going to sing a song called I Run to You. And I was thinking, sometimes we run away from God, but sometimes we can run back. We can run away from God, we can run back. So just remember the yo-yo. And next time you have a yo-yo and you're playing with it, and Emma, I want to see those tricks afterwards. Remember that sometimes we move away from God, sometimes we run away from God, but there's also the opportunity to run back, okay? And God knows where we are all the time, so we don't even have to worry about it because God is always there. Okay, let's have a prayer. Dear God, we thank you that even though there's times in our lives when we move away from you, you also remind us that we can come right back, that we can run from you, we can run right back, and that you're there wherever we are. If we're at school, you're there. If we're at the park, you're there. If we're at our friend's house, you're there. If we're at our grandma's house, you're there. So wherever we are, you're always there. Help us always to remember that, and help us always to remember that we can always run back to you, okay? In Jesus' name we pray this, amen. Okay, guys, thanks for coming up today. Okay, you guys get to go back with your folks, and Emma is gonna show me tricks after the service today, okay? And what's next on our list? We've got a musical offering.
The tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Fears, our hopes, our sins are one, our comforts and our cares. We share each other's woes, our mutual burdens bear. And often for each other flows the sympathetic tear. When we asunder part, it gives us inward pain, but we shall still be joined in heart and home. again.
Thank you very much. Today's scripture comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part. Then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three. And the greatest of these is love, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Pastor Lauren Michelle. Henry was a true gentleman. Henry was a true gentleman. When I arrived to serve a small church in San Jose, I would notice him holding the door open for others as he waited to come in. He was always impeccably dressed in a nice suit and one of his trademark bow ties. He had a round face and a short, well-trimmed mustache. He was at church every single Sunday. Now, this goes back a ways, but some of you remember, this is really going back a ways. Remember Captain Kangaroo? Yes. Henry looked sort of like him. It's a little bit like him. I can still remember where he used to sit in the exact same spot, in the far right hand, my left hand, his right, in the far right-hand side of the sanctuary. Not long after I arrived, I went out to visit Henry in his home. And I realized that here was a man in grief. He had lost his dear wife about a year before I arrived. They had been married for more than 50 years. And he showed me pictures of all the various places that he had traveled, the things they had done. It was obvious now that he missed her terribly. He even broke into tears as he spoke about her. Henry had been a man who had served in leadership roles all of his life. He had been a well-known doctor in town. He had served on boards and he had guided many, many projects. At the church, he had served in numerous ways and even chaired a number of committees over the years. But now, as I was sitting with Henry in his home, he was lonely and grief-stricken without his dear wife. He didn't know how he would go on or what else he had to offer. He was convinced that he was done. He was convinced that that was it. Today we are in the fourth week of our book, The Grace of Les Miserables. The great novel written by Victor Hugo takes place in France in the early 1800s. It's an epic story that spans generations and is at least partly about a redeemed criminal named Jean Valjean and the decisions that he makes throughout his life. We've mentioned that there is an authenticity in this story that reflects what each of us encounter in life and what each of us must deal with as we try to live out our faith. Today's story focuses on the girl named Cosette. You remember that Cosette was left in the care of a couple called the Thénardiers. It turns out that she was harshly treated by them, abused, and neglected. One night, however, on Christmas Eve, the Thénardiers, they send her out into the freezing cold to fetch water. Jean Valjean knew Fantine, Cosette's mother, and she knew that she had a daughter, and he is out there looking for her. And he finds her there on Christmas Eve, and he helps her to bring the water back to the inn. Now Jean Valjean is very different from the haggard, released ex-criminal that we saw at the beginning of the story. Jean Valjean has now become a prosperous and popular businessman who has just recently completed a term as mayor of the town. He offers the Thénardiers 15 francs for Cosette, and he takes her and raises her as his own daughter. Matt Rawl points out that this part of Les Miserables is a subtle nod to the miracle of Christmas. Valjean could either be seen as the Christ child or a kind of Saint Nicholas who saves Cosette from the Thénardiers. And it is this pivotal moment, this saving moment in the book, in the story, that will change both of their lives forever. Now let's take a look at the beautiful passage that Pastor Laura and Michelle read for us this morning. You might not know it in the reading of it, but Paul, who wrote this great passage, has a problem on his hands. He's writing to the church at Corinth, a church that is literally sort of ripping itself apart. The people in the Corinthian church, they were of all different backgrounds. They were of different religious backgrounds, different social classes. God had been revealed to them in a variety of different ways. Some had great wisdom. Some were healers. Some were prophets. Remember that great line? Some could speak with the tongues of angels, right? Unfortunately, the variety of people and their gifts had seriously divided the church. The church was growing weaker because of boasting and bickering that was happening among the members of that church. Paul could not believe that spiritual gifts, which he would acknowledge were completely given to individuals by God, were being used sort of as status symbols, occasions for pride, occasions for arrogance and boasting. So what Paul does here is he kind of shifts their perspective. In chapter 12, he says, to each is given the manifestation of the Spirit. So that to each is given the embodiment of God's Spirit for the common good. That's a key line, for the common good. Paul is basically telling them the reason for their gifts is to serve the community. That is, you may be speaking in tongues and find that to be very meaningful, but if no one else understands it and it doesn't make the community stronger, then the gift is being misused. The man named Henry, who I mentioned earlier, could have easily boasted of all that he had done and enjoyed in his life. His wonderful career as a doctor, his loving wife, the places they had traveled to, the financial gifts that he was able to make, the influence that he had all through that community. But you would never hear Henry boast. In fact, he could well have kept all those gifts to himself, but with Henry, it was never like that. There in those months after I met him, even in the midst of his continuing and ongoing grief over the loss of his wife, he stepped forward to serve the church once again. I remember I shared this one other time. Father William Lynch, a former Catholic priest, once said that hope is a sense of what is possible. Hope is a sense of what is possible, and Henry became an agent of hope in that church. He became part of the building committee at that church, which eventually inspired that little congregation of only about 140 people to raise more than $1 million to renovate and restore their crumbling sanctuary. Henry could have remained locked in his conviction that he had nothing more to contribute. He could have stayed right there in that place, but his act of love changed his future, and it changed all of our futures as well, those who were part of that congregation. People change their convictions in response to love. In the story of Les Miserables, more than any other character, Cosette is the one who gives hope. She is the inspiration. She is the beam of light in the darkness, both for Jean Valjean and the other characters as well. As she grows into a young woman, she falls in love with a man named Marius. They will eventually be married, and it is essentially their future together that brings hope to the entire story. It is what they envision, their life together, and the way others sacrifice to help them with that, that brings hope to this entire story. A key part of Les Miserables is that people change their convictions in response to love. Marius and Cosette have each been raised by men who are not their fathers. Marius has been raised by his grandfather, and Cosette has been raised by Jean Valjean. Marius joins in an uprising against the government. And because this is where he is politically, his grandfather basically kicks him out of the house, right? You might imagine, you know, in today's world, we got a Republican and a Democrat in the same house, you know, something like that, right? The grandfather basically kicks young Marius out of the house. However, when Marius is injured in the uprising, it is his grandfather who takes him back in and nurses him back to health for 6 months, and then gives him permission to marry Cosette. The political differences have been put to one side. Jean Valjean, for his part, only wants to protect Cosette, and he isn't too fond of young Marius. However, after Marius is injured in the uprising, it is Jean Valjean who carries him out to safety. As much as he wants to protect, like any parent, he also wants Cosette to be happy, and he is willing to sacrifice everything for that to happen. People change their convictions in response to love. The people who lived in Corinth had a very strong understanding of both honor and shame. It was kind of built into their culture. Those who were honored usually were those of great wealth, who had better education or intelligence, or were of a higher social standing. Those who were shamed were those of lower standing with less education and little, if any, money or wealth. Now, into this society, Paul comes and introduces a completely different value system. It's really the value system of all of us who try to live this system as Christians. It is a value system that encourages forgiveness, self-sacrifice, and seeing your fellow Christians, no matter what their wealth or status, as equal siblings in Christ. Back in chapter 4, Paul says, "To this very hour we go hungry and thirsty. We are in rags. We are brutally treated. We are homeless. We work hard with our own hands. When we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure it. When we are slandered, we answer kindly." He's saying to the Corinthians, my paraphrase here, this is a different set of values than what you are used to. If you are of Christ, you will follow this pattern of self-giving. If you are of Christ, you will put others before yourself. In our scripture reading for today, Paul gives the Corinthians the essential quality necessary to live out the Christian faith with one another. He says, love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Bringing this kind of love into our relationships changes the nature of our community. It changes the way we interact with one another. It is an approach that is desperately needed in our religious, our political, and our social lives today. Adam Hamilton tells us that this was the spirit that John Wesley brought to his early Methodist societies. He says, having a spirit like Wesley's today means that we assume the best of others, not the worst. We give them the benefit of the doubt. We speak well of others, not poorly. We treat them as we hope to be treated. We listen more. We talk less. We walk in another person's shoes and try to understand what they believe and why. This does not mean we give up our convictions necessarily, but it does mean that we test them. Adam Hamilton says, I found that after listening to another's point of view, some ideas that I was so completely sure of were not nearly so convincing. People change their convictions in response to love. Years ago, I heard the story of a Jewish family who, despite being targeted on a weekly basis by the local leader of a white supremacist group, consistently responded with compassion and care. Against all odds, against all probability, in the 1990s, a man named Larry Trapp, a leader of the Ku Klux Klan in Lincoln, Nebraska, made national headlines when he suddenly renounced his hatred, tore down his Nazi flags, destroyed his many boxes full of hate literature. He had previously sent hate mail and made threatening phone calls to this Jewish family. He had targeted their Nebraska synagogue for bombing. Now Trapp, the former Klan leader, had been confined to a wheelchair. He was now rapidly going blind due to diabetes. The Jewish cantor and his family, this is hard to believe, the Jewish cantor and his family invited Trapp into their own home to care for him. He said, they showed me so much love that I couldn't help but love them back. As this story obviously showed, we hear a siren. I always lift up a prayer for someone's in trouble somewhere. As this story shows, forgiveness allows the possibility of transformation. Although Larry Trapp spent the rest of his life repenting and seeking forgiveness from the many, many people that he had hurt. People change their convictions in response to love. And Victor Hugo doesn't sugarcoat that in Les Miserables, but highlights the internal struggle, the internal churning, you might say, that happens for each of us. I do think it's true in our culture that qualities like love and mercy and forgiveness are often seen as being soft or easy. But isn't it far more difficult, if you think about it, isn't it far more difficult to forgive someone who has wronged you than it is to despise them? Think about that. Forgiveness is a lot harder. Isn't it far more difficult to show mercy or work toward reconciliation than it is to simply let things continue as they have been? The way of love and forgiveness is not and is never really the easy way. And when Paul talks to the Corinthians about love, he is not giving them an easy way out. He wanted the Corinthians to know that the love of Christ, the love that Christ calls us to, is hard work. We might even call this love tough love, because it's the love that compels us to strive for unity, even when we may disagree with one another. By the way, and I've said this before, but it bears repeating, I do not believe that forgiving is the same as forgetting. I believe we can remember, but we can still forgive. And I also don't think that forgiving necessarily, it might, but it doesn't necessarily change the one who has been forgiven. But it does change us. It changes the one who forgives. Lewis Smead says this, the first and sometimes the only person to be healed by forgiveness is the person who does the forgiving. When we genuinely forgive, we set a prisoner free. And then we discover that the prisoner we set free is us. This was true for Jean Valjean in our story, and it's also true for us. People change their convictions in response to love. As we go forth today, let's remember that the love we are called to do is hard work. It was hard work for the Corinthians, and it's hard work for us. But let us also remember that there is a larger purpose involved, that God's presence and strength and compassion may be revealed here in our community and here in our world. Would you pray with me right now? Let's pray together. Loving God, challenging God, you place such high expectations before us. You wish for us to accomplish your work on a daily basis, but Lord, we would rather stay angry at someone than work toward reconciliation. We would rather hold on to the pain or the pride rather than risk showing compassion and mercy to someone else. It's often safer and it's often easier. Lord, forgive us for that. Help us to realize that these are the very things that block your presence, that block your movement. Help us to rise to your challenge. Help us to choose the difficult path of love and mercy and forgiveness toward others. We pray this in the name of the one who walked that path, who modeled that path for us, your beloved Son, Jesus. In his name we pray this. Amen.
Juggling all of this work. Thank you so much for the always beautiful music. One of the ways we can share love in community with one another is through prayer. And And so this morning, we are holding the following individuals and families in our prayers this morning. Bill and Margie Glorfeld, Helen Tucker, who is recovering from a broken foot, Tana Green, Jim Doty, and Pat Flower. And now, will you pray with me? Gracious, eternal God, we thank you for the love you have for us. Like the early believers, help us to find your guidance and to share your love with others. Lead us forward and help us to create a community where love, acceptance, and mutuality are expressed. Where joy abounds and where it may be said of us, see how those Christians love one another. Open the windows of our souls to the world and its needs. Send us forth to herald the good news of Jesus, to be your servants to those in need, to visit the sick and the imprisoned, to remember the forgotten in our society, and to work for justice and peace. Use our varied gifts so that we may show love to one another. In your name we pray. Amen. As we come together, both in person and online, we praise God's name and join the unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. Gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit in your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. For those at home, we invite you to use elements that you have available to you, bread, crackers, water, or juice. For those that are here in person, you have hopefully received one of two different forms of our individual communion today. If you for some reason do not have one and would like one, please raise your hand. The style that we've been using has two parts to peel back. One part lifts and you find a wafer. The second part lifts and you find the juice. The newer style that we're switching to, the only way you could really go wrong is if you open it upside down and end up with a lap full of juice. So, I would advise you to open the side with the little piece of bread first by peeling back the top, taking the little bread piece out, and then flipping it over and peeling back the part with the juice. the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Receive now these holy gifts in great thanksgiving. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. And now I invite you to please stand for our musical offering.
Thank you, music team. My friends, thank you so much for being here today. Receive now our sending forth, our benediction. Go now in peace, love God and serve the people, and may our God, the God who calls us to the hard, difficult work of love and mercy and forgiveness, may that God go with you now and through this coming week. Go into God's peace, go in God's presence, and go in God's grace. Amen.